This video is intended for no other purpose than to fully expose the false doctrine known as Hebrew Israelite religion, one that has led many astray from the true knowledge of Christ. At the close of this video, one point will be certain: God will be true and every man a liar.
And we're going to open up with the history. Let's go to 2 Maccabees 6 real quick. I just want to get the history because I don't want you to forget. Remember, the Apocrypha was removed out of the King James Bible by Protestant Christians back in the 1700s.
The first mistake that we see already is the professing of the Apocryphal Scriptures being removed by Protestant Christians. Now, the funny thing about this is that the original Hebrews themselves never looked at or viewed the Apocryphal Scriptures as being divinely inspired. And this is very surprising because Hebrew Israelites look at themselves as the scattered Jews or the Hebrew people. But it's confusing because these same people, not all, but most of them accept the Apocryphal Scriptures as being divine or removed by the so-called man, but the Hebrews themselves never viewed them as divinely inspired. Now, these Old Testament Apocryphal books were written in a time known as the Silent 400 Years, where Israel themselves didn't have a prophet until John the Baptist. Okay? Now, one thing you want to take of note is that in the New Testament, there are many Old Testament cross references, but there are none from the Apocrypha, not one. There isn't a book in the New Testament that says, as the prophet Judah or Esdras or anything like that. There's nothing like that in there. Also, you can look as hard as you want to look, but these Apocryphal books were not in the Hebrew Bible. They aren't in the Hebrew Scriptures at all. You can try as hard as you want to, but you won't find them there. So let's get to the Apocryphal Scriptures and see what they have to say about it. But before we do, I'm going to read from 2 Peter 1:21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Now, 1 Maccabees chapter 4, verse 46. And laid up the stones in the mountain of the temple, in a convenient place, until there should come a prophet to show what should be done with them. 1 Maccabees 9:27. So was there great affliction in Israel, that like whereof was not since the time that a prophet was not seen among them. 1 Maccabees 14:41. Also that the Jews and priests were well pleased that Simon should be their governor and high priest forever, until there should arise a faithful prophet. So the Apocryphal books themselves admit and attest that there were no prophet around. So if there was no prophet around, then where was the speaking? Or where was the people being moved by the Holy Ghost as they speak? The answer is there were none. But we're going to further blow this Apocryphal belief off the water. Next, we're going to go to the Apocryphal Scriptures and compare them with the Biblical Scriptures and show how they contradict and show how they do not agree with one another. Okay, now the moment of truth. Let's start with 1 Esdras 1:28. Howbeit, Josias did not turn back his chariot from him, but undertook to fight with him, not regarding the words of the prophet Jeremy spoken by the mouth of the Lord. 2 Chronicles 35:22. Nevertheless, Josiah would not turn his face from him, but disguised himself that he might fight with him, and hearkened not unto the words of Necho from the mouth of God, and came to fight in the valley of Megiddo. Okay, Necho was the Egyptian king, so it wasn't Jeremiah. Ecclesiasticus 25:24. Of the woman came the beginning of sin, and through her we all die. Romans 5:12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Judith 9:2. O Lord God of my father Simeon, to whom thou gavest a sword to take vengeance at the strangers, who loosened the girdle of a maid to defile her, and discovered the thigh to her shame, and polluted her virginity to her reproach. For thou saidest, it shall not be so, and yet they did so. Genesis 49:5-7. Simeon and Levi are brethren, instruments of cruelty are in their habitations. O my soul, come not thou into their secret, unto their assembly, My honor, be not thou united, for in their anger they slew a man, and in their self-will they dig down a wall. Cursed be their anger, for it was fierce, and their wrath, for it was cruel. I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. This was referring to the same situation that Judah supposedly is talking about, which happened a couple chapters earlier, where Simeon and Levi took revenge on Shechem and his villagers because Shechem had raped Tamar. So obviously these are two contradicting accounts, because Judah is saying that this is an act of God, while Jacob not only being a prophet but a man of God at that had cursed the anger. He definitely had a large disdain for the act that was done. So this is a blatant contradiction. This is the book of Wisdom, chapter 6, verse 17. For the very true beginning of her is a desire of discipline. It's talking about wisdom. Proverbs 9:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. Proverbs 1:28. Then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. 1:29. For that they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. So once again, another contradiction. Wisdom of Solomon, 14:27. For the worshipping of idols, not to be named, is the beginning, the cause, and the end of all evil. 1 Timothy 6:10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Ecclesiasticus chapter 3, verse 30. Water will quench a flaming fire, and alms maketh atonement for sins. Romans chapter 3, verse 24 and 5. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. And propitiation and atonement are pretty much the same thing. So if you're looking for a good read consisting of lying angels, noblemen of God ironically committing suicide, tales of dark power and wizardry, or just a good story to read your kids right before bedtime. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I present to you The Apocrypha, what fables are made of. Okay, so basically what I want to do is have a little piggyback off of what we just talked about, which was none other than The Apocrypha. So I'll start with 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. It's hard for the Apocrypha to measure up to this because it needs to be corrected in itself. Let's go to John 8:44. Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. So if there's anybody doing the lying, they're fallen angels, not angels of God. Also, the part in Tobit where he's instructed to make a smoke of the gall and the heart and things like that, this is not something that's consistent with Bible. In the Bible, the only thing the apostles had to do was use the power of the Spirit, which was God's Spirit, and cast a demon out in the name of Jesus. So let's look at that in Acts 16:18. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. So there you have it. There was no smoke. There was no fish involved. Just simply the power of the Spirit at work. So this is just one of many errors in the Apocrypha. If you want to further research it yourself, just go to your Google bar and type in a true church Apocrypha. And voila, there you go. There you have it. So you can just take your Bible and take the Apocrypha with you and make your own comparisons and distinctions. Okay, this is a very touchy subject because there's a lot that hangs on this concerning who the Gentiles actually are. Now, many of the Hebrew Israelites, if not all of them, they mainly associate the Gentiles receiving salvation to those of the Northern Kingdom. And one thing that's very interesting about this is that when you had the exile, those that came back were mainly Jews. They were mainly those of the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom really didn't bother to come back. On top of that, you have scriptures such as Hosea that talks about God separating or severing a people and whatnot. So the New Testament, you have the term Jew, which is applied to the Hebrews or extended to the Hebrews without distinction. But however, mainly the New Testament consists of those in the southern kingdom. So it's tricky. It's very tricky. But at the same time, if we're going to properly debunk this, and I don't mean by way of semantics, which a lot of Hebrew Israelites perform, but we're going to have to start with their loopholes concerning Gentile doctrine.
John chapter 7, verse 35. Then said the Jews among themselves.
Then said Judah amongst themselves.
Whither will he go that we shall not find him?
Where's Christ going that we can't find him?
Will he go unto the dispersed?
The word dispersed means scattered. Go ahead.
Among the Gentiles?
Who was dispersed amongst the Gentiles? The Israelites. The northern kingdom primarily.
And teach the Gentiles?
What did they call the northern kingdom of Israel? Gentiles. Read the whole verse again.
Then said the...
This is the New Strong's expanded, exhaustive concordance of the Bible. And it's arguably the best in the game, if not easily one of the best Bible concordances out there. And it has Hebrew and Greek dictionaries and so forth and so forth. Definitely a good tool to use. Case in point, in a situation where you're trying to clear some things up. So this is what we'll be getting into, and this is what I'll be using to disprove the Hebrew Israelites' point on what the Gentiles were in this particular scripture. Okay, so for some of you out there, I'm gonna go ahead and give you a moment, get yourself together, because that right there, it's a head buster. Definitely a head buster, can't be nothing else shy. But I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna read it for you. 1673, Doag. Doag, active participle of 1672. Anxious, Doag, an Edomite. So these people who the scripture was talking about in John 7:35, they were not people of the northern kingdom. They were Edomites. They were Greeks. So to further, you know, bust this wide open, we're going to have to find out exactly what a Greek is.
Israel shall be saved.
So Christians are not to be saved.
I'll be more than happy to. So, first thing that we have right here is the English version or the English definition of what a Greek and a Grecian is. So, if you're paying attention like I am, you see first and foremost that Grecian can mean the people of Greece or inhabitant of Greece. Also, it means Greek-speaking Jews, which is another definition. But beneath that, skipping to the definition of what a Greek is, you see native of Greece. You also see foreigners speaking Greek. So we see from these two definitions that they're different. I don't know exactly what kind of Bible the guy was reading. I think he said Zondervan's or I don't know if he was reading it correctly or what. Well, I know he wasn't reading it correctly, but that's beside the point. But anyway, we're going to go ahead and get into the Greek of what a Greek is. So we can go ahead and close the book on this. 1672, Helen from 1671. A Helen, Grecian, or inhabitant of Hellas, Greece, just what we showed in the English version, by extension, a Greek-speaking person, especially a non-Jew, Gentile, okay, Greek. So how, in this instance, can a Greek be a Greek-speaking Jew when it's emphasizing that it's not a Jew at all is far beyond my understanding, but let's continue to read. Originally denoted, the early descendants of Thessalian, Hellas, Greece. Number two, Greeks as opposed to barbarians, Romans 1:14. It became applied to such Gentiles as spoke the Greek language. Since that was the common medium of intercourse in the Roman Empire, Greek and Gentile became more or less interchangeable terms. Gentiles, John 7:35. Okay, same scripture we was just going over not too long ago, where the local church is distinguished from Jews and Gentiles. So a Greek is not a Jew or Israelite. We know that. So I think we can close the book on this. This is definitely a huge topic of interest, considering the fact that Hebrew Israelites believed Jesus Christ to be a black man during his first advent. However, the making of graven images is something that the Bible condemns. Exodus chapter 20, verse 4. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. So the Bible clearly teaches us that we're not supposed to make images of any sort concerning these things. John 4:24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So without further ado, let's do more investigation.
We're reading Bible prophecy, black man, black woman, Hispanic man. Who went into slavery with ships? You Native Americans, you Hispanics in 1492 when the conquistadors came. You went into slavery by way of slave ships. Wait a minute, he said, how do we know what? How do we know what? Give me Revelations 1.
Revelation.
Listen, this is the nonsense that you deal with in Christianity. All talk, no scripture. You've been doing this for how long, brothers? How long? Let's get it. Revelations 1. I'm going to show you Jesus Christ was a black man.
That's right.
Read that.
That's Revelation chapter 1, verse 14. His head and his hairs were white like wool.
His head and his hairs were what?
White like wool.
His hair was colored white, and the texture was woolly. Come on.
As white as snow.
As white as snow. Read on.
And his eyes were as a flame of fire.
And his eyes were as a flame of fire. Read.
And his feet.
And his what?
His head and his hairs were white like wool. His head and his hairs were white like wool. His head. And his hairs were white like wool.
So according to the definition that you just seen on the screen just a little while ago, we can obviously tell that this picture to our left does not add up with what's actually being stated in the Bible. But however, this summarizes and sums up the ministry of Hebrew Israelites in itself. And that's to plainly change the image of God into something that they want it to be, into an image of their own. Romans chapter 1, verse 22. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible man, into birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things.
Let's see if this is the only place to read about Jesus. Give me that. Daniel 10 verse 5.
Daniel chapter 10 verse 5.
We're getting it from the Lord, the Bible. Let's go.
Then I lifted up my eyes.
Come on.
And looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen.
He said he did what?
Lifted up my eyes.
He lifted up his eyes. Read.
And looked.
And looked.
And behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose loins were girded with fine gold of Euphrates.
The same vision John the Revelator seen in Revelations 1. Read.
His body also was like the pearl.
His body was like the pearl, yet on a green garment. Come on.
And his face as the appearance of lightning.
Read.
And his eyes as lamps of fire.
Same thing we read in Revelations 1. Come on.
And his arms.
And his arms.
And his feet.
And his feet. Read.
Like in color.
Like in what?
Color.
What?
Color.
Color. Read.
To polish bronze.
It's telling you his what he looked like.
So it's one thing I want to clear up before we further get into it. The picture with the Legos, I wasn't using that as a means to say that that individual had everything right about the image of Christ. But I just wanted to use it to get an idea of what the head was, as opposed to what they had it as, the scripture concerning Revelation chapter 1. But we're going to further disprove the fact that Jesus is this guy that is talked about in Daniel chapter 10, and which he wasn't. Daniel chapter 10, verse 12. Then said he unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thy heart to understand, and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. So now I'm going to read a little bit of Matthew chapter 4, the Jesus encounter with Satan. Matthew chapter 4, verse 8. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them, and saith unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then saith Jesus unto him, Get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. So there's a huge difference, whether you realize it or not, about these two different instances. In Matthew chapter 4, Jesus Christ simply rebuked Satan, him having that godly authority because he is God, rebuked Satan, and Satan left. The angels did not come until after Satan left. So when Jesus Christ, in his human form, was tempted by Satan, he was in his vulnerability. So when God came down his first advent into a human flesh, that was his vulnerability. But it's easy to believe or to get caught up in that this person in Daniel chapter 10 is Jesus Christ, if you don't believe Jesus Christ is God, in which a lot of Hebrew Israelites don't believe. But however, these two different instances, they speak for themselves. Jesus Christ simply rebuked Satan and he left. He wasn't withstood 120 days. On top of that, he didn't need the assistance of something that he created. Colossians 1:16. For by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist. This is talking about Jesus. Jesus Christ doesn't need the help of something that he created. In this instance, the Archangel Michael.
According to scriptures, Joseph is the father of Christ. Next brother goes, no, Christ didn't have no daddy. That's confusion, brother. No end. Go ahead.
I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commit iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men.
Did Solomon commit iniquity?
Yes,
he did. Go ahead.
I will chasten him with the rod of men. And with the stripes of the children of men.
Let me ask you a question. Solomon sinned, but was he chastised with the rod of men? And with the stripes of the children? That means a whooping. Did that happen to Solomon?
No.
Who did that happen to?
Christ.
It happened to Christ. Okay, everybody see that?
Yes.
Hmm.
we see a little bit of what we're working with here, and it has to be one of the biggest hypocrisies for people to claim that the Bible is divinely inspired and yet not believe in the divinity of Christ. Now, they look at this as immaculate deception, but we're going to further debunk that and break that down and further prove it as false. Let's start with Luke chapter 2, verse 47. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, How is it that ye sought me? Wish ye not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. Okay, so we know two things from this. Mary said that her and his father, you know, and according to that context, Joseph was looking for him. But Jesus Christ replied and said, I must be about my father's business. So it couldn't have been Joseph's business that he was talking about. Matthew chapter 1, starting at verse 1. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judas and his brethren. And as you read down along the list, you'll see a long list of begats. But when it comes to Joseph or Jesus, it's never listed that Joseph begat Jesus. Matthew chapter 1, verse 16. And Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. And I'll put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. This was talking about Jesus Christ. And it says the seed of the woman. Now, anybody that really knows something about this particular subject, women don't bear seeds. But if you read Matthew 1:18, it says that Mary was found with child via the Holy Ghost. So it was never the seed of man through which Jesus Christ came. John chapter 12, verse 31. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. A few times in the Bible, you see the word prince, like Prince of Persia and things like that. It's talking about angelic beings. In this instance, it's talking about Satan. This is what Genesis 3:15 was talking about. The seed of the woman, which was Jesus Christ, will overthrow Satan and diffuse the power that he had. Now, you have a lot of people in power, whatever, that worship Satan, but Satan really doesn't have much power unless people give it to him, yes, unless they yield themselves to Satan. So I have one more scripture. Isaiah 53:5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. So in a clip earlier, it was talking about beating Jesus with the rod of men and his stripes. But the thing is that Jesus Christ didn't sin. As the scripture in Isaiah 53:5 says, he was wounded for our transgressions. So they weren't his transgressions that he was wounded for. Jesus Christ is known as the sacrificial lamb. And the thing is, in the Old Testament, people had to transfer their sin unto animals once they were, you know, right before they were sacrificed. So likewise, Jesus Christ took on our sin and took on our burdens. They weren't his burdens. Because if that was the case, then he wouldn't qualify to be a sacrifice if he wasn't perfect and sinless, as the lambs were supposed to be without blemish.
And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?
So this young man comes to Christ and says, Good master, what do I have to do to receive the kingdom of God?
Bring it out.
Let's read.
And he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one.
Christ is telling you, I'm not good. There's only one that's good, and that's the Father. Read.
So this is one of the few scriptures that they use to try to disprove the deity of Christ. In this particular scripture in Matthew 19, Jesus Christ was being sarcastic with this individual. It was his way of asking him, do you really know who you are talking to? If not so, then Jesus Christ wouldn't have said what he said in these following scriptures. John chapter 10, verse 11. Now in Matthew 19, he said, only one is good, and that's the Father, right? Here's what he says in John chapter 10, verse 11. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Skip down to John chapter 10, verse 14. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. So if what I said wasn't true just a few moments ago, then why would Jesus Christ call himself the good shepherd? I thought no one was good except for the Father. But Jesus Christ is the Father wrapped in flesh. So moving on to further validate my point, let's go to Hebrews 4, verse 15. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. So once again, it goes back to the point I was making about the lamb without blemish. You can't offer a lamb unless it was without blemish. Jesus Christ doesn't have any blemish. Him is a blemish with sin. Jesus Christ was not blemished at all with sin. And the Bible clearly says in the scripture, Hebrews 4:15, that he had no sin. So if only God is without sin, then who is Jesus Christ? But there's so many evidences that we're going to get into it as to prove Jesus Christ was and is God, but was God while he was on earth in the flesh. So we're just going to close out with a couple other major topics. The first thing is that Jesus Christ forgave sins. And it's sort of impossible for a man with sin, you know, a man period, but a man let alone with sin, to forgive sins. You know, we all know that only God can forgive sins, of which Jesus forgave. Mark chapter 2, verse 5. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, Why doth this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only? Not only so, but Jesus Christ was worshipped. As we all know, only God is worthy of worship. Matthew chapter 28, verse 17. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Matthew 14, 33. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, Of a truth, thou art the Son of God. So basically, when you see the word or the title Son of God, it's basically saying God in the flesh. Let's go to John 5:18. Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. We all know that there's only one God. So further on, if you read the Bible more than enough, you'll come across certain circumstances and situations where people denied worship, such as Acts chapter 10, verse 26, where Peter denied worship, Revelations 19:10, where the angel denied worship, and Acts 14:13 through 15, where Paul and Barnabas denied worship. So what makes Jesus Christ so different? Well, the answer is in itself. It's in the scriptures itself. Jesus Christ was and is God.
And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee.
Now here comes the Christian.
There they go.
The Muslims say that the angel was banging Mary in the back room. Well, what are you talking about? You know, that's adultery.
So in verse 34, she didn't know she was a spouse.
Right. She didn't know she was promised to her. Go ahead.
And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God.
So now, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee and overshadow thee. What is the Holy Ghost talking about?
That's right.
Abiel?
The law.
Right. This, the word is going to be fulfilled in her. Yes. Give me that in Acts 7.
51.
Come on. We got to get that. Because Satan, angel came down, done bang, 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 bang. That didn't happen.
Jerry Springer. We're going to the book of Acts chapter 7 and verse 51. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost, as your fathers did, so do ye.
So that's what we want, the Holy Ghost. Our fathers resisted the Holy Ghost, we don't.
Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one.
Here come.
Of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers.
Come on.
Who has received the law.
Stop. Who have received the law. Go ahead.
By the disposition of angels.
And what?
And have not kept it.
That's what they were resisting.
So we see yet another miscommunication. In this term or in this reference, it's the Holy Ghost being the law. The Holy Ghost isn't the law. So we'll further prove that. John chapter 7, verse 38. He that believeth on me, as the scripture have said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. So we see here that the Spirit and the Holy Ghost are synonymous. They're the same. Next, I would like to compare the baptism accounts of the four Gospels. Matthew chapter 3, verse 16. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. Mark 1, 9 and 10. And it came to pass in those days, or in those, that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway, coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open, and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. John 1:32. And John bare record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. Luke chapter 3, verse 21. Now while all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape. I'll read that again. The Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape like a dove upon him, and a voice came from heaven which said, Thou art my beloved Son, in thee I am well pleased. So there you have it. We saw in multiple scriptures where the Holy Ghost was seen as the Spirit, in which it is. It has nothing to do with stone tablets. One more scripture I want to give. This is in reference to John 7, 38 and 39. This is Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now we should have enough sense to know that the Spirit is not the law. So there's nothing else I should have to say in debunking this. So before we get to the next situation at hand, I just want to clear this up and polish this a little bit about why the Holy Ghost is not the law. I just want to read a couple of scriptures. John 4:24 says that God is a Spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. You understand that through the baptism accounts, through the Gospels, and other scriptures that I've given prior to this, these scriptures now, that the Spirit of God was synonymous with the Holy Ghost. When I say synonymous, I mean it's another term they use for the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost. And we know that John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Okay, so it doesn't say that the law was there. In Galatians chapter 3 verse 17, it says that the law was given 430 years after Abraham. So it's impossible for the law to be God when it was given 430 years after Abraham. On top of that, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9 says that the law was made for sinners. In the beginning, even a little while after that, in the Garden of Eden, the law wasn't present, because the law wasn't necessary where there was no sin. There was no sin in the garden. The sin didn't happen until Adam decided to disobey God in return for obeying his wife. So it's impossible for the laws to have been right there. So even if it would be, so hopefully I cleared that up and proved the point as well.
Shalom. Most High in Christ bless you. My name is Officer Zakai, and I want to introduce you to Original Royalty Recordings. So I'm going to start off with a scripture in the book of Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 19. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. So we want to bring you the theme music for your walk with the Most High in Christ to help you with that singing of the melody in your heart to the Lord. We want to bring the music in the form of hip hop, in the form of R&B, in the form of traditional gospel, you know, with the emphasis on biblical topics. That's what we want to do.
You know, big respect to every religion, every philosophy that's out there. You know we had to study them all to write this. Big respect to everybody. Hip-hop is a servant to every seeker of light. Everyone. We ain't putting ourselves above nobody. We are the servants of all cultures and religions and philosophies. But I tell you this, man. Those that know about the cycles of time, and like the Fibonacci code, sacred geometry, those that know about how every 26,000 years we undergo a new cycle, every 2,600 years a new cycle, those that know that August 11th, 3,114 BC, starts the beginning of this age. This age started its decline 5,000 years later, August 11th, 1973, when Kool Herc came out with his first party. Hip-hop is divine. This, we're not just rapping. This is divine speech we giving. That's why when you say, I'm criminal-minded, you attract that to you. And I'm living witness in wisdom. I mean, I wish my DJ was with me right now. That ain't no bullshit. You say criminal-minded, you attract criminal-minded to you. You say, I'm ready to die. Wow.
That's a good point.
We spit in divine speech, and it's time we start really recognizing.
You know, at the end of the day, I'm going down as a legend, whether or not you like me or not. I am the new Jim Morrison. I am the new Kurt Cobain. You know, they feel like, yo, you know, he's got a God complex because he said if they wrote the Bible again, he would be in it. Duh, yeah, I would be in it. I feel like I'm one of the more important people, you know, in pop culture right now. One of the only people with an opinion. The Bible had, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 characters in it. You don't think I would be one of the characters of today's modern Bible? And people have their own forms of Bibles now, you know? It's a new day and age. People have their own thinking. People have their own things that they're into. People have their own religion. Hip-hop is a religion to a certain extent, and the rappers are the preachers, and the music is the scriptures. You know, it's just like church, because you go to a concert, you raise your hands in the air, you get dressed up, you sing songs, and you definitely pay some money. It's just like church.
The Bible and hip-hop are complete opposites from one another, more like oil and water, so much so that hip-hop in itself, in its essence, is at variance against God. So for these individuals to incorporate hip-hop into their scheme is just as bad as the holy hip-hoppers. And that's basically what this is, to be honest. Holy hip-hop without officially or actually stating it. And we all know hip-hop isn't holy to begin with. Also, for these individuals to profess themselves as Israelites, they definitely line up with the Israelites of old and engaged in idolatrous practices, which was pretty much one of Israel's greatest downfalls. Further on, I just want to go ahead and read an excerpt from KRS-One's interview regarding hip-hop as a religion. Alright, here it goes. Rap pioneer KRS-One is a self-proclaimed prophet of a new religion, hip-hop religion. KRS-One announced he will soon release the gospel of hip-hop, which he's already released, so this is a little older than, a little older than what some people might think. This happened like some years ago. The First Instrument, a 600-page book that examines the spirituality of hip-hop culture. The hip-hop artist and founder of the Stop the Violence movement, KRS-One, aka Boogie Down Productions Teacher, claims his soon-to-be-released spiritual book is the announcement of a new hip-hop religion on Earth. This is him quoting, "I'm suggesting that in 100 years, this book will be a new religion on the Earth," KRS-One said of his new book, which claims hip-hop to be the world's dominant new religion. KRS-One goes on, "Well, I think I have the authority to approach God directly. I don't have to go through any religion. I can approach God directly myself, and so I wrote a book called The Gospel of Hip Hop to free us from all this nonsense garbage right now. That will include you, Hebrew Israelites. I respect the Christianity, the Islam, the Judaism, but their time is up." To recap, KRS-One's book is a new Bible. It's going to be the best-selling book on Earth, and no matter what God thinks, hip-hop is a new religion of the world. So, to me, it's kind of funny, it's kind of baffling as to why these people would want to adopt hip-hop practices into their music. On top of that, hip-hop has their own temples. They already have their own Bible, and we know they make their own music. So without a shadow of a doubt, this thing is definitely a religion in itself. So to incorporate hip-hop music and try to blame it on the emphasis of using biblical topics, like I said before, it's no difference than people claiming to use holy hip-hop. Like, hip-hop isn't holy. Like, we should already know that it isn't. You can't take something that doesn't have a holy origin and try to make it holy. That's like trying to purify fornication or any other thing that God has already condemned.
Once again, what did he tell us? Thus said the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen. Thus said for what? Lord, learn not the way of the heathen.
So here's one of the core errors and core mishaps along the lines of what many Hebrew Israelites believe, and that is the denying of water baptism. And I'm assuming that is because Christians themselves are dipped in the water. You know, they actually go under the water in baptism. So it's a way for them to be anti-Christian. But what they fail to realize is it's also a way to be anti-Christ, because Christ was also baptized himself. And that is one of the main reasons why Christians do it. So they use scriptures such as Ephesians 5:26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. And this scripture right here is one of many scriptures that they use in a way of semantics, is to apply a scripture and that completely has nothing to do with the point that you might want to make. And they try to take it as is. But we'll get down that road a little more. But just a few scriptures to prove baptism is required with water. Acts 10:47. Can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? So this is Peter talking. And after these people received the gift of the Holy Ghost, he still wanted to baptize them. Acts 8:36. And as they went on their way, they came into a certain water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? Verses 38. And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they came, and when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord called away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. So we see from these scriptures that these people were being baptized even after Jesus Christ ascended back into heaven. So water baptism is very, very necessary, as Christ said himself. John chapter 3, verse 5. Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. And it's kind of ridiculous to think that this natural water, this natural element, is talking about the Word. Although the word cleanses us, yes, that's true. But at the same time, Jesus Christ himself said we all must be born again of water and spirit. And we see through the various scenes in the book of Acts that these people were doing just that. This water that the eunuch was talking about was not the water of the word. They couldn't step into the water of the word. The water that Jesus Christ was baptized into and came out of in Matthew 3:16 was not the water of the word. It was the natural element, water. It symbolizes our death and resurrection to the world and to new life. But it's very necessary. So if you're looking on the screen right now, you'll see the definition that I have. It's kind of a shame. It's kind of sad that I would have to go to a Bible concordance to see what a simple definition of water is. But you can look at it and see that it's talking about water, the natural element. Actually, one of the more amusing topics of discussion that I've also had with a few Hebrew Israelites. I don't think this is necessarily a Israel United in Christ issue, but nevertheless, it's still a Hebrew Israelite issue. But you have Hebrew Israelites out there that believe that sex makes the marriage. So if I'm with somebody and I have sex, that's just my way of marrying that person, as opposed to, you know, going through the exchanging of covenants and vows and things like that. But we're just going to go ahead and sort of just get this out the way. Genesis 2:24, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. So we see from this scripture that Adam and Eve were already married. Genesis 4:1, and Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. So this is her first son, obviously. Genesis 4:17, and Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bare Enoch. So we already see in multiple situations where as though you have people that are having sex, but they're married. You know, the scripture says that these men knew their wives. It didn't say anything as in regards to they slept with these people and they became their wives. It didn't say anything like that because they were already married, which further proves the Bible's point and disproves their point. And it's very amusing because you have certain Hebrews that believe that the Apocrypha is divinely inspired and that it was taken out the Bible by the white man for whatever reason. But these people that believe in the Apocrypha and believe that sex makes a marriage, this is where they smack themselves in the face because, well, we're just going to go ahead and read Tobit 3 and we're going to start at 7. I'll let you see it for yourself. And it came to pass the same day that in Ecbatane, a city of Media, Sarah, the daughter of Raguel, was also reproached by her father's maids, because that she had been married to 7 husbands, whom Asmodeus, the evil spirit, had killed, before they had lain with her. Dost thou not know, said they, that thou hast strangled thy husbands? Thou hast had already 7 husbands, neither was thou named after any of them. So the very Apocrypha that they claim to be divinely inspired goes against their own beliefs, because it says that this lady was married 7 times, but never had sex with any of the people she was married to. So that pretty much does that. So this doctrine that you try to muscle in and sneak in as to be something of God is actually none other than something of the devil.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?
Wait a minute. So now we're gonna back up again. Back up to the bottom of verse 2. I want you to see what the Bible says. Bottom of verse 2.
Mm-hmm. And they shall take them captives, whose captives they were, and they shall rule over their oppressors.
So the oppressor, now verse 4.
Verse 4. That thou shalt take up this proverb against the king of Babylon.
So the oppressor is called the king of Babylon. Now verse 12.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?
Now it's calling the oppressor Babylon Lucifer. I'm going to say it again. It went from calling them the oppressor, calling them the king of Babylon. Now it's calling them Lucifer. Read it again.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?
Now this is where the dumb pork chop eating preacher who loves the white man goes, see there? God got into a fight because the devil started a rebellion. They got into a fist fight. And God beat Satan up and kicked him out of heaven. Dad ain't talking about that. Read it again.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer?
Let me give you a precept to help you in your understanding. I'm going to give you a precept with the Israelites. Lamentations 2, verse 1. I'm going to give you a precept to explain being cast from heaven.
Lamentations chapter 2, verse 1.
Listen good.
How hath the Lord covered the daughter of Zion?
Daughter of Zion are the Israelites.
With a cloud in his anger.
He was angry with us.
And cast down from heaven unto the earth.
He cast the Israelites what?
And cast down from heaven unto the earth.
The Israelites were cast down from heaven unto the earth. Read that again.
And cast down from heaven unto the earth.
So let's pause there and let's meditate on that a second. Were the Israelites flying around in heaven? Where they had wings flying around? No, moron, no! What does it mean when it said the Israelites were cast down from heaven to the earth? They went from ruling. When we came out of Egypt, we were the top nation. And we fell and went into slavery.
So this is the backbone of Hebrew Israelite religion. And that's basically something known as semantics. And basically, you can't just go around using the same word and the same definition for every instance that you see that word in the Bible. Because all the words in a dictionary, they have multiple meanings. They have multiple definitions. So it's impossible to take one word and apply it to every context, every sentence that you use it for. That's impossible. So let's start with Matthew chapter 18, verse 10. Take heed that ye despise not one of these little ones. For I say unto you, that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven. So we see that Jesus himself has stated another context in which this word heaven is used. So obviously there must have been a lot of flying around and tweeting in this scripture that Jesus Christ has given. Next I want to talk about Lucifer and how Hebrew Israelites look at Lucifer as the white man, which is a complete lie from the pits of hell. And it's funny because they talk about other people having Stockholm Syndrome, but it's like, it's sort of like they exhibit a slave master mentality or slave like mind, because anytime you put the white man on the level of Satan, which I think is 2 Corinthians, that views Satan as the god of this world. So anytime you put a man, let alone a white man, I can care less any type of man it is, but in this particular instance, the white man, on par with Satan, it shows your slave like mentality to begin with. So the same thing that they claim to liberate you from is like they're putting you more and more into it. But anyway, let's talk about Lucifer. Ezekiel chapter 28 verse 12. Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus and say unto him, thus saith the Lord God, thou sealest up the sum full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardius, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, interesting, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou was created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created, till iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty, and thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. Okay, so if you read one of the definitions that I have on the screen, it talks about Lucifer and it lines up the definition with brightness. So if it's something that we need to learn from Ezekiel, from this particular passage, is that sometimes these prophecies are going out to Satan. We know this for the simple fact that this king of Tyre wasn't in the Garden of Eden. He wasn't there. On top of that, he's not a cherub or the anointed cherub. So they're talking about an angel, okay? And that's what Satan is. He's a fallen angel, as described. But we're going to get more into that, but I want to go ahead and show you more clips of what they view Satan is and further debunk that.
Genesis 25, verse 24. And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red.
The first of these twins came out red. The first one came out red. Go ahead.
All over.
From the top of his head to the soles of his feet.
Like in hairy garment.
Like in hairy garment, meaning he came out hairy as well.
And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his heads.
Why is it saying this great red dragon? Great red! Why is it saying red, Tony? This dragon represents what? Great red dragon. Give me Job 30 and 30, I think it is. You know what I want? Yeah. Job said, I'm a brother.
The owls and
Job 30 verse 29, write this down. Read it.
Job 30 verse 29. I am a brother to dragons. and a companion to ours.
Job said, I'm a brother to dragons. Who was the brother of Israel?
Esau.
What color was Esau?
Red.
Red. You with us, Tony? Tony, what did it say Esau's color was?
So let's further prove that Esau is not the great red dragon. Let's go to Revelation chapter 12, starting at verse 7. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was there a place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So one of the obvious things here is that Michael the Archangel is not going to fight white people. Or is not going to fight man. Like, you're not going to find that in the Bible that Michael is fighting men. It wouldn't be much of a fight to begin with. But we have to go to other places in the Bible where they pinpoint Satan or the serpent or any of these references given to Satan. So let's start with Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God hath made. And he said unto the woman, yea, have God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? So we see in the book of Genesis chapter 3 that the serpent is in the garden. Now, according to the scripture that they read themselves, Esau didn't come into play until Genesis chapter 25. So we know that Esau can't be the serpent, because in Revelation, the scripture that we just read, it gave Satan the same title as the old serpent. And we find the old serpent in the garden, in which Esau was not there. Neither was the king of Tyrus. I don't know if you remember that, but a little bit further back, we talked about how the king of Tyrus was not in the garden, but Satan was. So once again, it does more to prove the point that the great red dragon is not Esau, but it's Satan.
And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman.
So this serpent, the so-called white man, cast lies out of his mouth through his media after the 12 tribes of Israel. Go ahead.
So in case you might need a little more clarification or a little more information as in regards to Satan being a fallen angel instead of the white man, I just want to go ahead and finish this out and give a couple more revealing scriptures proving my point that Satan is not the white man. I'm going to start with Luke chapter 22 verse 3. Then entered Satan into Judas, surnamed Iscariot, being of the number of the 12. Luke chapter 10 verse 18. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. So two things I want to get straight about this. Luke chapter 10, 18 goes back unto Isaiah chapter 14 as in terms of referencing Lucifer. Luke chapter 22, verse 3, Satan entering into Judas is not talking about gay sex here. So it's impossible for it to be talking about a man. It's talking about a spirit. Since you had other incidents and other situations where people were demonically possessed or had these so-called demons inside of them. Let's go to Mark chapter 5 verse 12. And all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. This is the story about the man in the grave. Not in the grave, but necessarily in the graveyard. The man that came out to meet Jesus in Mark chapter 5. He was possessed, so much so that the demon said, our name is Legion, for we are many. So he was possessed with many spirits. Mark chapter 5 verse 13, and forthwith Jesus gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. They were about 2,000 and were choked in the sea. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So flesh and blood refers to humans. That's obvious. We all should know that. Okay? Now, white people as well have none other than flesh and blood. But yet we see in the scripture that the Bible tells us this is not what we war against. We war against spiritual wickedness in high places. Talking about Satan and his angels. They also made a reference talking about Esau being the great red dragon because Esau has a red type of skin. But let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 17 verse 42. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. Song of Solomon chapter 5 verse 10. My beloved is white and ruddy, the chiefest among 10,000. Now, I don't think the white part refers to necessarily him being Caucasian or anything like that. I think it's a different reference and a different translation in the Greek and Hebrew, but that's not the case. That's not the point I'm trying to make. But the point I'm making is that both David and Solomon had ruddy skin. Ruddy is a reddish color. So to refer to a person as Satan because they have a red texture is quite silly, because you even have people who are part of the Hebrew Israelite camps or Hebrew Israelites period that have a reddish color skin. So that's garbage. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. For in time past he walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. Once again, this is referencing Satan. Alright, Satan is a spirit, he's not a human. Now it's a scripture in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, I believe, that says that Satan is the god of this world. Now a lot of people try to make the point that it's referencing the white man because of a scripture in Job, which says that God gave the world to the hands of the wicked. But what people fail to realize is that the wicked was granted authority in the garden where the white man was not at, or where the white man wasn't. So the dominion shifted from man unto Satan, not necessarily from the black man to the white man.
The only one who can create a new world is me.
No, you're just a murderer, Light Yagami. And this notebook is the deadliest weapon of mass murder in the history of mankind. You yielded to the power of the Shinigami in the notebook, and you have confused yourself with a god. In the end, you're nothing more than a crazy serial killer. That's all you are.